by stripes we are healed. The beauty that we should desire Him, despised and rejected by men. He came to His own, they forsook Him, led to the cross as a lamb. Now there's no other name by which men can be saved. So Lord, I come.
So we made it through verse 20 in Matthew chapter 7, and finishing up, getting near to the conclusion of, or actually we're on the conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount, and perhaps we'll just cover where we're headed in our outline. Remember, we started with the Beatitudes in chapter 5. We went into the 9 sinful attitudes to watch out for. Jesus gives warning, and He gives proper interpretation and meaning to what these are. He raises the bar in so many cases of what the Jews typically understood and how they practiced the law of Moses. But He's showing that God's law operates out of a law of love, and that if you love your neighbor as yourself, which is the golden rule, you fulfill the law and the prophets. And that was reiterated in Matthew 22, 37 through 40. We looked at that God said, or Jesus said, that if you love God supremely with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and that you love your neighbor as yourself, this fulfills the law of Moses and the prophets. So this, all of obedience in keeping God's law, it stems from a heart of love. And it's loving to obey the commandments, because you're doing what's best for your neighbor, and you're doing what's best with what God wants and in relationship with God. You're being faithful to Him. So love and obedience are coupled. We'll get into that a little bit lower here. And the fourth bullet point, he said, enter through the straight and narrow gate and go along the narrow way. And I understand that to be Jesus. We have to all come through Jesus. Jesus says he is the door to the sheepfold in John chapter 10, verse 9. And that if any man will enter in by him, he shall be saved, and he shall go in and out and find pasture. And he came to give us life and life more abundantly, he says in verse 10 of John 10. He also says in John 14, 6, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. He's the only way to the Father. No man gets to the Father but by him. So Jesus is that narrow gate that we must all pass through. He's the door, meaning, what does it mean he's the door? We have to believe on him, that he is our atonement. He is our Savior. He is our only means of righteousness, God's righteous atonement. We have to put our trust on him as Savior, but also as Lord. And when we make Jesus our Lord, it means we're laying down our own life, we're yielding our own will, and we're embracing God's will for our life and what he commands, what he teaches, what the destiny he has over our life. We are embracing that, and we are reckoning our old man, ourselves, dead to our own plan, our own will, and we're putting God's first and foremost in our lives and on this narrow walk with him. Then he goes into bewaring of false prophets. So there will be those out there who will come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravenous wolves. They're gonna look like Christians on the outside. They're gonna look like Jesus, you know, trying to obey Jesus, or give at least a false pretense that they're Christians. But when you look at them, they have corrupt fruit. Jesus likens their actions, their character, likened unto fruit. As a tree, you know a good tree is a good tree, not by the bark, not by the branches, but by the fruit it produces. If it produces lemons, if it produces oranges, if it produces apples, we would consider those good fruit. But if it produces thorns, it produces thistles, or some scrubby looking poisonous berry, that's corrupt fruit. We would never eat it. So he's using that as an example to look at those who come in the name of Jesus, but their character doesn't line up with the character of Jesus. So they're not going to function from a heart of love. Remember, love is the overarching character trait that God operates in. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. So anything, even if they're doing miraculous works, even if they're doing wonderful works, casting out devils, healing the sick, and they don't function in love, that's considered nothing to God. So everything that we do for God must emanate from a heart of love, and God's supernatural love flowing through us. And that will only come as we draw close to him in our prayer closets and yield our hearts to him and embrace that relationship with him. So it's opening ourselves up, allowing him to examine us, speak to us, and fellowship with us. And he will impart unto us his agape love, is God's type of love. And an agape love, it's a Greek word meaning selfless. You know, you're doing what's best for others, regardless of the cost to you, regardless of the consequences to you, in light of eternity. It's a selfless type of love, and that's God's love. So all this should function from a heart of love. There is then, in point number 6, a warning to obey from a heart of love. And we know that love and obedience are coupled together. There's many scriptures that talk about this. I brought up just a few here. John 14, verse 15, Jesus said, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments." I mean, that's pretty simple. That's right before he went to the cross. He told his disciples, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments." Right there, that joins love and obedience together. Because some people try to say obedience is just, it's just legalism. Jesus saved us from the law. We don't have to obey all these commandments. He's just going to overlook them, and we function in this greasy type of grace, which is God blinded now to how you live, and you don't really have to do what Jesus wants you to do. And that's a false doctrine. You know, it says in the New Testament, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. So holiness is never been dropped by the wayside, but you should always function in love. Love and obedience are coupled together. If you have faith, you don't have true faith unless it's coupled with your works. It says faith without works is dead faith, right? So works are going to be a response to hearing the word of God and doing the word of God. We are going to be judged in the end by our works. And that will be, you know, your works respond from a heart belief of faith, but then the completed faith is doing it. And we're going to be judged in the end by our works. So it's very important to obey the Lord, and we're going to see that in the end of the Sermon on the Mount. But in John 14:21, it says, if you keep my commandments, my Father will love you. It says, he that loves me will keep my commandments, and him will my Father love, and I will love and manifest myself to him. In verse 14:23 in John, it says, he that keeps my words, him will my Father love, and I will love, and we will make our abode with him. We'll make our dwelling place with him. So when you're functioning in love and obedience, the Father and the Son are going to come and dwell inside of you, as well as the Holy Spirit. Now, that's a spiritual concept. It's very deep. How does that happen? The Trinity, they're three, but yet they're one. And I look at it as there's three personalities, but they can layer over each other and be a part of each other. And they can be a part of us. We're made in God's image. So it's very technically deep, but that's the best way I can envision it. That we can have the Lord living and dwelling inside of us in our hearts. So your functioning in love is always going to function with obedience. Love keeps all the law and the prophets. That's what Jesus told us in Matthew 22, 37, and 40. If you walk in love, you fulfill all the law and the prophets. So, and then we're going to get to the end. And we're going to go through these. The wise man will endure the storms of life. I got live there, but life. And the wise man will hear and obey. We'll go through this. And the foolish man is going to crash and burn. And he's going to hear, but he doesn't obey. That's the difference between a wise man and a foolish man. They both hear, but one obeys and one doesn't obey. One does what Jesus says. One doesn't do what Jesus says. So, you know, looking back on the Sermon on the Mount, this is what Jesus is saying. Just many of the bullet points that Jesus is saying. So we want to get this right. Okay, so that's kind of where we've come from, where we're headed. And we'll try and get through the end of the Sermon on the Mount. So Matthew 7:21, Jesus goes into this and he says, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father, which is in heaven. And look how the Passion says it. It's only those who persist in doing the will of my Heavenly Father. There is a persistence. There is a doing. It's not just one and done. It's a persistence. We're in it for the race. We're in it for an endurance race. And so Jesus himself is saying, doesn't matter if you say Lord to me. Not everyone who says Lord to me is going to enter the kingdom of heaven. That's pretty sobering. Now, we talked about Jesus being the door. We talked about Jesus being the straight gate that we have to enter through. Well, this is the final entrance right here. When you pass from this life, you're going to stand before the Lord. Is he going to let you in? He's saying, no, not everybody is going to be let in. You got to go through him. And we're going to Let's look at some scriptures that kind of back this up. So Psalm 15, a psalm of David, says, Lord, who shall abide in your tabernacle? A tabernacle is a tent. Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? So the tabernacle was the tent in the wilderness. God told Moses, gave him a very specific pattern for the tent of meeting where God would come down and meet. It had a holy place. It had a holy of holy place. It had an outer court. So the tabernacle of the children of Israel was given by heaven. The pattern was given by God. And only the high priest in the actual physical tabernacle could enter in one time a year on the Day of Atonement. The tabernacle transitioned into a temple. It was Solomon's temple, and then that one was destroyed by Babylonians, and then they rebuilt the second temple after the Babylonian captivity, and then that was the one that was around when Jesus was on the earth. That was called Herod's temple. Herod added to the temple later. Herod was a wicked king, but the temple was brought about. Nehemiah was sent back, Ezra, and they were sent back to restore these things that had been torn down. And so, but the tabernacle is where, you know, God's image of him dwelling with man. So it was not that he needs a building to dwell in. His intent all along was to dwell in the heart of man, to fellowship, just like with Adam and Eve, where when he created Adam and Eve, he would come in the cool of the day each day to fellowship with his creation. That was lost in the fall. God is restoring that, and that is the intimate. That's why, you know, I talk about the intimate fellowship. That's what God wants. That's why he created man. Not to have somebody just keep a set of laws and be indifferent to him. No, it was to know what God is like, to become what God is like, and to have a loving fellowship with God. So David's saying, who shall abide in your tabernacle? Who shall dwell in your holy hill? So there's a qualifications here. He says, he that walks uprightly. All right, so this is, we talked about, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. He that walks uprightly and works righteousness, or is always, or and speaks the truth in his heart. As the Passion says it, they are passionate and wholehearted, always sincere. Sincere has the indication of honesty. And always speaking the truth, for their hearts are trustworthy. There's nothing untoward. There's nothing malicious in their hearts. They don't think ill of other people. You know, they're not trying to harm other people. They're not looking for self-advantage and to take advantage of others. You know, they're looking at how they could bless others. They're looking at others as valuable human beings, creations made in the image of God. So, you know, that you just think about, just kind of meditate a little bit on what these words might mean. Verse 3, he that backbites not with his tongue. So Jesus said that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So words are just a symptom of a bad heart. When bad words come out of your mouth, it's an indication that you have a spiritual heart issue. Because out of the, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And that's in Matthew 12, like around 33, 34. So in when he talks about that, he says, either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt. For out of the treasure of the heart, the mouth speaks. Or I'm kind of getting that a little bit off, but it's close to the concept. But he says, every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof on the day of judgment. For by your words you shall be justified, and by your words you shall be condemned. So here David has learned from God, he that backbites not with his tongue. Backbiting is slandering or insulting others. Nor does he do evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach against his neighbor. So, you know, taking up a reproach against your neighbor that would harm another with their words, or they would listen to gossip or rumors. I think that's what, how the Passion interprets that. Taking up a reproach against his neighbor would be like listening to gossip or rumors about other people and entertaining them. You know, when you hear a gossip or a rumor, you should cut it off when it's regarding somebody else. Like, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. Okay. Verse 4. In whose eyes a vile person is condemned, or he's passionately against evil and evil workers. And then he honors them that fear the Lord, or commends the faithful ones who follow after the truth. This is another important point. He that swears to his own hurt and changes not. And what that means is you make firm commitments and follow through, even at great cost, even when it can cost you something. Like if you, you know, with your words, you say, hey, can you hold that for me? And I'll give you $100 for it. But I got to come on Friday to get before, you know, to give you the money. But hold it for me. Don't sell it to anybody else. And then you go away and you find out, oh, wait, I can get it for $50 at Best Buy. What do you do? You got to keep your word at that point as a Christian. It's like, oh, no, I promised him that I would give him $100, even though it's going to cost you $50 by keeping your word to your brother that you were going to buy something from. Those kind of things. It's the one who swears to his own hurt because that's the right thing to do. Because your brother potentially could have sold it to somebody else, but he was holding it for you. So you never, you know, even if it's going to cost you money, if, you know, you try to avoid those type of things, but sometimes you have to keep your word over your own advantage. So God looks at these things. And then the final verse in this chapter, he that puts not out his money to usury, that would mean you don't put it out for interest, or they never crush others with exploitation or abuse. And then it says, nor takes reward against the innocent. That would be not taking a bribe against the innocent. Right? So those in public positions, like judges, they're tempted to take bribes. Politicians are tempted to take bribes. Because if they take a bribe from some special interest group, that special interest group now gets their way in the government. Or a judge can be bribed to rule in a person's favor. So God looks at these things. Never take a bribe against the innocent, and they will never be shaken. They will stand firm forever. So these are, remember, these are the people, because the question's asked, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? Holiness is pretty important to the Lord. Jesus here in the Sermon on the Mount, verse 21, is saying, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does, there's an action there. He that does, and in the Passion, he that persists in doing the will of my Father, which is in heaven. So doing and walking out our faith has a lot to do with abiding with the Lord, being in fellowship with the Lord, loving the Lord, and finally coming through that final door of the Lord when we enter into the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so John 13:13. Now, this is just, they're calling him Lord, Lord, right? And Jesus said this in John 13:13, you call me Master and Lord, and say ye well, for so I am. So he is our Lord. He is that only, we should only call, say that to God. We don't call man our Lord. I mean, we would call him boss, you know, but he's not the Lord of our hearts, the Lord of our lives. He's not going to be our final judge. But Jesus is saying, yes, you call me that, and you, that's right to do, for so I am. And that's interesting how he says, so I am. He is the I am. God called, said to Moses in the burning bush in Exodus, Moses said, who shall I say sent me? And God responded and said, tell him, I am that I am sent you. That's the name of God. And so the Jews know that. And when Jesus uses that, oftentimes they would take up stones to kill him because they thought he was committing blasphemy, making, being a man and calling himself God. All right, 1 Corinthians 1:26, for ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, nor many mighty, not many noble are called. So, you know, think about this. This is talking to Christians, and those who enter into the kingdom of God, it's not based on their worldly wisdom. He's saying wise men after the flesh. Wise men, guys who get around real well in this world. You know, they're street smart, street savvy, or whatever. They know how to get around in this world. They're not in the kingdom of God. And not many mighty men. You know, you see the mighty men on the earth. Not many mighty are called. Not many noble. Why? Because you have to be poor in spirit to enter into the kingdom of God. You have to mourn over your sin. Right? That's not how the world works. The world says, you know, be proud about yourself. And, you know, what you can set your mind to, you can achieve. Right? They try to bolster their own, you know, you can achieve anything you set your mind to. They try to do that in their own strength without God. And that principle of pride and exalting yourself and, you know, the pride of life, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, those are all principles of the world. And anyone who practices those things, it says the love of the Father is not in them. So often that goes against the kingdom of God. And we have 1 Corinthians 13:1, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity or love, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And so he's saying here, they speak with the eloquence in earth's many languages, or in heavenly tongues of angels, because angels have their own languages. Yet I don't express myself with love. My words would be reduced to the hollow sound of nothing more than a clanging cymbal. Bang, 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 bang. You know, that's all you would sound like to God, because you're not functioning in love. You might have all these mighty gifts, but they're not emanating from a heart of love, because God is love, right? So in God's economy, he's saying, you just sound like a clanging cymbal to me, an annoying cymbal, because you're not functioning from a heart of love. And he goes on, he says, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries, you know, these are spiritual mysteries or God's hidden secrets, and all knowledge or supernatural knowledge, possessed unending supernatural knowledge, and though I have all faith. And we know that Jesus said the greatest faith we can have is faith that removes mountains. That if we say to this mountain, and that's in Mark 11, if we say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and we believe in our heart and we don't doubt, we'll have whatsoever we say. Well, here he's saying if we have that kind of faith which could remove mountains, but we don't have love, I am nothing. This is Paul saying that. So you got, these are spiritual gifts. You've got prophecy. You can speak prophetically the word of God. You understand all spiritual mysteries, the hidden secrets of God. You can go into his word and get out hidden secrets. And you understand supernatural knowledge. And you have all this great faith. And you can see things manifest in your own life that God gives you. But you don't have love, you have nothing. So it's all, love is the overarching principle. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, so you give all your money away to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, you're willing to die for Jesus, and have not love, it profits me nothing. Pretty important. What the motivation of your heart is. Love suffers long, or is incredibly patient. This is what love is. This is what God's love is. Love is large and incredibly patient. Love is gentle and consistently kind to all. It refuses to be jealous when blessing comes to someone else. Love does not brag about one's achievements, nor inflate its own importance. I mean, that's pretty amazing right there. It's gentle, it's consistently kind, and incredibly patient. It refuses to be jealous when blessing comes to someone else. You can imagine how jealousy can arise when you see someone else being blessed. Love does not brag, boasting. It's not, no boasting, and boasting about one's achievements, nor is puffed up or inflate its own importance. You know, telling others how great you are. Love does not traffic in shame and disrespect, nor selfishly seek its own honor. So that's interesting. Doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own. Okay, so I don't think you would, I think what it means is love does not shame others and disrespect others. That's how I'm reading that. Nor selfishly seek its own honor. So you're not just looking for you to be honored. You're not looking to shame others or disrespect others. Love is not easily irritated. So you're not quick to be angry or easily provoked. You know, how quick, remember we talked about anger in the Sermon on the Mount and how that's one of the nine sinful attitudes to watch out for. And it's a progression, right? You can get angry in your heart. You can get angry to the point where you begin to boil over and explode. And it just progresses all the way to be guilty of hellfire. So here, this is what God's like. He's not easily irritated or quick to take offense. Love joyfully celebrates honesty and finds no delight in what is wrong. Love is a safe place of shelter, for it never stops believing the best for others. Love never takes failure as defeat, for it never gives up. So it bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And love never stops loving, or the way the King James says it, love never fails. And but where there is prophecies, they shall fail. Where there be tongues, they shall cease. Where there be not, or whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. Okay, so love is the most important thing, and this is what I think we need to take away from the end of the Sermon on the Mount. So verse 22. Now he goes on. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? All right? So these are Christians. They're standing before the Lord, and they're expecting, hoping, wanting to be led in to the kingdom of God after they leave this earth, and they're emphatic. Right, Jesus said it in the previous verse. They're going to say unto him, Lord, Lord, but they're not going to be permitted to enter. Here are the same people saying, Lord, Lord, and they've prophesied in thy name. So remember, we looked at 1 Corinthians 13, right? Paul says, hey, if you prophesy and you don't have love, it's nothing. Right? Look at what these guys are claiming. They're saying, hey, we prophesied. Oh, didn't you read 1 Corinthians 13? You didn't do it out of love. And in thy name have cast out devils. Well, they didn't have love. Why didn't they have love? We're going to see why they didn't have love. And in thy name done many wonderful works. So they did these miracles in the name of Jesus. And they're calling Jesus Lord. They're emphatic. That's why they're saying, Lord, Lord. They're emphatic. Like, Lord, hey, look at our resume. Look at what we've done. And the Lord doesn't refute that they did these things. And then the next verse, verse 23, and then I will profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, you that work iniquity, or I've never been joined to you. So they knew Jesus, they knew about Jesus, they've accepted Jesus as Lord, they're calling him Lord, but what does Jesus say? He doesn't say that they didn't know him. he says, I don't know you. I don't know you. Right? So, whoa. They didn't know Jesus, or Jesus didn't know them. So it's not so important that we know him, but that he knows us and we're abiding in him. And there's so much to say on this topic. John 15, it says, if we abide in him and he abides in us, that we're likened unto the branch, he's the vine. And without him, we can do nothing. Our life comes from abiding in him. So he must abide back in us. But the issue here is working iniquity. Okay. So here's a point Jesus made in Matthew 21:31. They gave a parable of two sons. And it said, I'll go back. A certain man had two sons, and he came to the first and said, son, go work today in my vineyard. He answered and said, I will not. But afterward, he repented and went. So the first son says, no, dad, I'm not going to do it. But then he comes to himself and says, I'm going to go do it because it's my dad. And he came to the second and said likewise. And he answered and said, I'm going to do it, dad. But he went not. So he told his dad he would do it, but he didn't do it. Jesus asks, which of the two did the will of his father? What would you say? The second one?
Oh, the seventh.
Or the first?
Sorry.
The first one.
I thought
the first one.
Misread the body language there.
No problem. They say unto him the first, Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you that the publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. So he's going to rebuke them because they're like the second son who claim to be close to God, but they don't do the will of God. So this is what Jesus is saying. Oh, wait a minute. These publicans and harlots are coming to repentance. They're not doing the will of God, but now they're repenting and coming into the kingdom of God. So they're the ones who said, I'm not going to do the Father's will, right? They're sinning against God. Then they get poor in spirit. They mourn over their sin. They see Jesus. They accept Jesus, believe on him, and they come into the kingdom of heaven. Now they're doing the will of God. But it's the religious ones who think that they're doing the will of God, but they have the outward pretense, but they don't do the will of God. So that's what this parable is meaning. So, you know, it's going back to how do you get into the kingdom of God? Psalm 1:6, for the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. 2 Timothy 2:19, nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure, having this seal. The Lord knows them that are his, right? Jesus said, I don't know you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. Here's the foundation of God standing sure, having this seal. The Lord recognizes those who are truly his. He knows them that are his. Right? And let everyone that names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. So that's the second one. These guys couldn't go in because of lawlessness. They couldn't go in because of iniquity. And these two foundations these are two seals, two points that are the foundation of the kingdom of God. The Lord knows them that are his. So it's about relationship. Are you in a loving relationship with God? And let everyone that names the name of Jesus, you know, all these people, these guys saying, Lord, Lord, depart from iniquity. That was their issue. They were doing works of God. They didn't depart from iniquity. They weren't functioning from love. And as a result, they're not going to be allowed to come into the kingdom of God. So here's a verse in 1 Corinthians, again from Paul, chapter 8, verse 3. But if any man love God, the same is known of him. So I think this is a really strong verse for, notice how it's loving God, as we learned in Matthew 22, loving God supremely and then loving your neighbor as yourself. But if any man loves God, the same is known of him. So, you know, committing iniquity is not loving God, obviously, or loving the people you're committing iniquity against. But you're also not known of him. And here, love and being known of God, the two are coupled together. Let's see. I'm kind of trying to get back to my... Here we go. 1 John 2:19. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. So just showing you believers that were not functioning in love. They began with them, and however, they didn't function in the same spirit of love. So there was a division, and so there's a separation. There's going to be a separation to those who don't walk in love and obedience to the Lord. So this is just happening in this earth. It can happen in this earth, but will ultimately happen when we stand before the Lord. Matthew 9:13, but go ye and learn what this means. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. So this is the Lord. He came, he was eating with, he called Matthew his disciple. Matthew was a tax collector, and then Matthew had a feast for Jesus and had his friends come, and they were harlots and other tax collectors. And you know, these Pharisees look outside and they see Jesus in with his disciples in a tax collector's house, and he's looking at this, they're looking at this, and in their own self-righteousness they're saying, how can you eat with these men who are sinners and women who are sinners? Don't you know what kind of reputation these people have? And this is why Jesus came. He came not to call the righteous. He came to call sinners to repentance. So those who are already walking close to God, they don't need to repent. Jesus came. He says his name shall be Yeshua, for he shall save his people from their sins. Yeshua is Jehovah saves, or is salvation. That's the name of God. It's Yehovah in the Hebrew. And we say Jehovah in the English. It's like a transliteration of it. But that's what his name means. That's what his mission is. He came to save men, not only from their past sins, to offer a blood atonement for them and forgiveness and a pardon, a judicial pardon before God, but also to save them from the power of sin, that they could live unto righteousness. They could live unto holiness. They could be made in the image of Jesus. They could walk as Jesus walked. It says in 1 John chapter 4 that herein is our love perfected, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. We're walking like Jesus. That's how our love is made perfected, in that will give us, because we're walking in love, we're walking as Jesus walked. It says we'll have a boldness on the day of judgment. You know, there won't be a fear and an angst because you are known of the Lord, because you're walking in love. All right, so verse 24. Therefore, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that hears these sayings of mine and does them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. All right, so Jesus likens this unto the building of a house. In my mind, the house represents your life. And what's important in house building is before they begin to build anything upward, you know, the two stories that go above ground, or how many ever stories of the building go above ground, you've got to dig down first. You've got to go down before you'll ever start building up. And so they spend all this time digging a hole and trying to dig down to bedrock. They don't want to just put a structure and all that weight on sand or on soil, because that load, that weight is going to shift over time, or water's going to get under. If you're in a northern climate, it's going to freeze and expand and move that and shift that building. No, it's important to get below, well, to get below the frost line if you're in the north, right? There's a temperature line in the soil that you get below, and it's the temperature is in the 40s, or, you know, it's going to warm up. It's not going to be freezing. So, but anyway, to put all that load of those walls onto it, you want to make sure your foundation is built on a rock. Or in modern days, they pour footings. You know, they pour cement concrete footings like a sidewalk underground that go around the perimeter of your house, and your walls sit on this sidewalk underground. So that's the modern equivalent of building on a rock. And now, over time, there's going to be no water getting under there and shifting the foundation. The walls are going to be put on. The house is going to stay square. It's going to stay true. You're not going to have a leaning, like the Leaning Tower of Pisa in Italy. What, that's famous to this day because it has a tilt to it. They didn't have a firm foundation, and when it settled, it had a lean. So Jesus is saying, build, you know, you do this in the natural for a house. And what makes a house endure the rain that's going to descend on it, in the floods, the river rises, right, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, but it's not going to move because it's founded upon a rock, in verse 25. But building on sand is foolish because that house is going to collapse. So we have to build our house on one of two things. We hear Jesus's sayings and we do them. That's what Jesus said. The wise man is the one who hears these sayings of mine and he does them, right? He hears these sayings of mine and does them. That's the wise man. And then the foolish man is the one that hears these sayings. So he hears them also, but he goes his way and he doesn't do them. And that's what James says true faith is. Faith is hearing and believing on what God says. It's like reading the Word of God in your devotion, and you believe it. But then if you go your way and forget it, and you don't do it, the Lord is calling you foolish. But if you take it to heart, because the scripture tells us faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So you hear, you read God's Word, you meditate on it, Holy Spirit gives you a revelation, and then you don't do anything with it. That's the foolish man. You're gonna crash and burn at some point, because the storm is going to come. The rain's going to hit your house, your life, and you're going to collapse. You're going to fail under that spiritual pressure, and you're going to fail. And then you're going to have to go to God. What did I do? What, you know, how did I mess up? And the Lord will show you. I told you, and you didn't do anything with it. So that's, if you want to be wise, when you read God's Word, always ask, Lord, how can I apply this to my life? How does this apply to my life? What should I do with this? How should I act? You know, that's a constant meditation that the Lord will, as you present yourself in your prayer closet and get in your prayer closet and pray to your Father in secret, let Him reveal things to you, show Him His will for your life. You know, let Him do an assessment on you. You know, did I mess up? You know, that's how important it is to be still and know that He is God, that He can speak to you and give you an assessment every day, like, you did this wrong. That's not how you should have handled this. You know, but you have to open yourself and present yourself to Him. Say, Lord, how could I have done that better? And then let Him speak to you. And then you make those corrections. You hear what He has to say and you do it. And so that's your walk of faith with the Lord. And it's also the walk of intimacy, of developing that love relationship with your Heavenly Father. and getting alone with him. And then you'll learn, Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. He, in John 10, he says that my sheep know my voice. You'll learn to hear his voice. You'll be able to discern it as you quiet yourself from the distractions, from the other distracting voices out of your life, and you'll begin to recognize it, and you'll begin to obey it, and you'll begin to follow his voice, because you know it's always, he's always going to be for your best. It's always done out of a heart of love for you, and you, in response, want out of a heart of love to obey what your Father says. You know you want that fellowship. So anyway, now there's some supporting scriptures. So yeah, Matthew 13:16, Jesus says, blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For verily I say unto you, that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which ye see, and have not seen them, and to hear those things which ye have heard, and they have not heard them. All right, so how blessed it is, Jesus is saying to these people, that you hear them and that you see them, because many righteous people wanted to, but they weren't able to, that lived before you. And so it's a blessing. It's a wonderful blessing. It's an amazing blessing to hear what God is saying and then to do it. Luke 11:28, Jesus said, blessed are there. Well, there was his family. No, somebody cried out in the crowd, blessed is the womb that bare thee, and the paps, or the breasts, which thou hast sucked as a child, right? That nursed him. And he said, no, rather, or yea, rather than that, it's more blessed than being my mother. It's more blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. Just what Jesus is saying in the Sermon on the Mount. You know, they're saying, you know, many Catholics would say, oh, the Virgin Mary, blessed is, and she was blessed among women. She's not divine, like the Catholics think. We don't pray to Mary, anything like that. But she was blessed in that she was the mother of Jesus, the physical, natural mother that God impregnated Mary with, you know, Jesus's body. But Jesus says, no, more, it's more blessed than being my mother, of my physical body, that if you hear the word of God and keep it. And that's meant for every child of God, anyone who is born again. You're more blessed if you not only hear it, but keep it. John 13:17, if you know these things, happy are you if you do them. Right? So again, Jesus equating knowing, having faith, and doing. Happy are you if you do them. You know, he's just reiterating it. Matthew 12:50. For whosoever shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother. So this was when, if you go back a few verses in verse 47, someone in the crowd says, behold, thy mother and your brethren. So he had, I think it was five brothers and at least two sisters we know of. Might have been four brothers. Natural brothers from Mary and Joseph. You know, Jesus. Joseph was his surrogate father, his adopted father, right? Natural father. But they had, Mary and Joseph had other sons and daughters. In fact, the book of James is Jesus's brother, okay? Half-brother. And somebody cries out and says, hey, your mother and your brethren, your brothers, stand without, desiring to speak with you, right? So in this world, the concept is blood is thicker than water, right? So your relatives are supposed to have the highest preeminence in our lives, like drop everything for your family. But he answered and said unto him, and told him, who is my mother and who are my brethren? And he stretched forth his hand, it's like he pointed out to the crowd toward his disciples, and said, behold, my mother and my brethren. For whosoever shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother. So those who do the will, hear it and do it, have preeminence. That means Jesus is knowing you. You are in a loving relationship with him. He's elevating you to his children. He's elevating you to his brethren, is what he's saying. That's pretty awesome. That's how the kingdom of God works. Isaiah 58:2, yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching to God. So this sounds like they're coming, that they have transgression, and they're acting. They seek the Lord daily to delight and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness and forsook not the ordinance of their God. So they're playing a part where they're acting like they love it and that they seek God, but they have forsook him. They forsook God's ways and his law. They ask of me the ordinance. Now they want justice, and they take delight in approaching unto God, but they are not doing it from an honest, sincere heart. They don't do the will of God. They're hearers, but not doers. That's what Jesus warned against. That's like a foolish man. And ultimately, their spiritual life will collapse when the storms come. James 1:22, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. That's Jesus's brother through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So you have to be a doer of the word, not just a hearer. So it just goes right back. It's all throughout Scripture. Jesus is just telling you how it is. Don't be a hearer only. Be a hearer and a doer. Again, in James, a little bit further down. This is what a person is who hears and doesn't do. He's like, he beholds himself in a mirror, and then he goes his way and straightway forgets what manner of man he was. So that's what being a hearer and not a doer is like. You perceive how God sees you in the mirror of the word, but then you go out and forget your divine origin. You don't do it. So 1 Timothy 6:19, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. And that's what we're after, laying hold of eternal life. That's the wise man. That's the hearing and doing. That's the loving and obeying. Obeying from a heart of love. And that's only going to come through your prayer closet, intimate fellowship, meditating on God's word, allowing the Holy Spirit to speak to you through God's word, and then acting it out in your life. And he's going to help you day by day as you present yourself to him, as you read his word and meditate on his word, not just read through in a hustle and then you don't even know what you've read in the end. Now, there is some faster reading plans, which are good. It's good to be exposed to the Bible. It's not like you're going to get nothing out of it. You're going to learn. But ultimately, as you develop, as you continue to grow, you really need to slow down in certain areas and dissect. You know, when you come to a point you don't understand, and it's like a red light, you know, it's like a stop. Like, hey, Lord, what's this mean? Give the Lord a chance to speak to you on it, meditate on it, do maybe a word search on it, you know, spend some time, and you'll see the Lord will just begin to give you treasures and show you what it means, and then you can enact that in your life, and you'll be excited to do it because he's giving you truths. Isaiah 28:16, therefore thus says the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believes shall not make haste. And I think this is talking of the Lord. He is called the stone that the builders rejected, that if any man would you know, fall on this stone. How does that go? Fall on the stone and be broken. But he that doesn't, the stone would crush him to powder. The stone would fall on him and crush him to powder. So Jesus was likened unto a stone, the cornerstone. The cornerstone kind of sets the square of the building. So it has to be a stone that is perfectly square at a 90 degree angle. So this is a foundation stone, a tried stone, and it's a precious cornerstone. And that's Jesus, a sure foundation. And he that believes on him, that's the issue. Believing on him and obeying him. 1 Corinthians 3:11, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So what we just read in Isaiah, pointing to Jesus, this precious cornerstone, he's our foundation, can no man lay. And he's the, you know, Jesus Christ is that foundation. How are we doing? I'm almost, we're getting close. 1 Timothy 1:1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God, our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope, right? So Jesus is our hope. It's about knowing Jesus. He's the door, like we talked about. He's the one who, it's important that we, that he knows us and that we're in that loving fellowship, right? Without love, love never fails. And if we do things with iniquity in our heart or without love, it's as if it's nothing, right? Even faith can be as nothing. You know, how many people think faith is very important, which it is. However, love is above faith. And if we do things without love, then it's as though our faith is nothing. So, yeah, they're all related. And the important part is who you know and being known by him, and that's Jesus, our Savior, our Lord. He is our hope. Luke 14:30, saying this man began to build and was not able to finish. So this is counting the cost, talking about the foundation. And Jesus said he likened being his disciple to having to bear a cross, that whosoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple, right? So we know the cross is an execution stake. And then he tells men, hey, if you want to be my disciple, sit down and count the cost first. Don't just jump into being a Christian, because he wants you to have a true understanding of what it may mean. He says, you know, for which of you intending to build a tower sits not down first and counts the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it, lest haply or otherwise he may lay the foundation and not be able to finish. The neighbors will ridicule him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish or complete it. So count the cost to be his disciple. He says that, you know, whosoever he be of you that forsakes not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. So there's a cost, and we should recognize that he is our foundation stone, and we build our life on Jesus. So when the man digs down deep and builds on this, the foundation, our foundation is building on Jesus and what he says, and learning to hear what he says and obey what he says. And that's what our life is. You know, if we're counting the cost to be his disciple, we have to understand we're going to have to take up our cross. We're going to have to bear a cross, because Jesus is going to take us in a way that we may not want to go all the time. And are we really willing to sign up for that as a Christian? But we know that we're the reward. We know the prize. The prize is everlasting life, everlasting joy with the Lord. How could you not turn it down, no matter what the cost in this earth? All that he's paid for us, because we know eternally if we don't have Jesus, we are in our sin, and we know the wages of sin is death and in separation from God in a lake of fire. So he is our all in all. He is our everlasting life. Okay, where were we at? Okay, 1 Corinthians 3:13. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. So this is likened to the judgment. When we stand before the Lord, it's our works that are going to be judged. And they're going to be made manifest by fire. And so we have to pass through the fire of God's judgment. And everything that's not motivated from love is going to burn up in this judgment fire. It says it likens some works unto hay, wood, and stubble. But if they're rubies, precious metals like gold and silver, they're going to last through the fire. We're going to have reward that remains. But all of it's going to be revealed by fire. And so, you know, that's why Jesus is saying, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, the ones who said, Lord, look at the wonderful works we've done. Look at the devils we've cast out. Look at what we've prophesied in your name. They weren't able to pass through the fire when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, because they had iniquity in their hearts. 2 Timothy 4:7, Paul says at toward the end of his life, I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith, right? So we can have a confidence, a boldness in the day of judgment, because Paul was walking in love. So he knew, see the confidence he had? He's about to face death when he wrote this. Writing to Timothy, a younger elder in the church, and he's saying he's confident. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. I've not denied the Lord. He knows me. There's a boldness there. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Are you in a love relationship with God? Do you love him when he shows up in your life? Or are you just looking for what you can get from God and you really don't want to obey and hear everything he has to say? You know, if you begin to love the Lord and love his appearing in your own life, there is a reward laid up for all those. And the Lord's going to reward everyone with that heart. Okay, so that's the Sermon in the Mount, the Sermon on the Mount. And, you know, you can see that that's a very foundational teaching. I like to think of it as the Christian Constitution. And you're going to see these concepts. You've seen them throughout the scriptures. And so you can always go back to, I think, the Sermon on the Mount and see, you know, the main message Jesus taught is in there. It's trusting in him, coming to him for salvation, avoiding these sinful habits, developing character, the character of the Beatitudes in your life, and coming through the narrow door, loving your neighbor as yourself, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. This is the law and the prophets. Jesus said, the greatest two commandments, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. That fulfills all the law and the prophets. So we have to emanate love. We have to work from love. We saw the characteristics of love in 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 to 8. Love is patient. Love is kind. It's not envious. It's not self-serving. It's not rude. It doesn't brag. It's not puffed up. It doesn't take reward against the innocent. It rejoices in the truth. It hopes all things, endures all things, bears all things, believes all things. Love never fails. And we've seen how love and obedience are tied together, and how we have to have a hearing ear. Jesus said the wise man is the one who hears and obeys. The foolish man is the one who hears and doesn't obey, right? And his spiritual life is going to collapse. The foolish man's house is going to collapse when the storms come. The wise man who hears and obeys Jesus. Those teachings we just went through and others that are going to be added, But again, the Sermon on the Mount's kind of like a Rosetta Stone or a Constitution, not a Rosetta Stone, but the Constitution. A touchstone, perhaps, is the right word to say, of our Christian faith and knowing Jesus. You know, because he taught us how to pray, and he taught us how to get alone with the Heavenly Father and develop that relationship. And love is so important. Jesus is our foundation. He is that cornerstone, that precious cornerstone. And then I've got these last two verses. And it came to pass when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine. I mean, they're like overwhelmed. Do you feel overwhelmed? They're overwhelmed at his teaching. It's like, wow, what just happened to us? What, this is so out of the box. You know, we don't hear this from our teachers. They don't teach God like this. This is not how they say to know God. They say, I got to obey the rules. I say, I got to keep the feasts. I got to keep the Sabbath day. I got to keep all their rules. They're made up rules on the Sabbath day. You know, this isn't how our rabbis teach. I mean, they're floored here at what Jesus said. Because Jesus is bringing truths from heaven, because he came from heaven. Where did my mouse go? Okay, and for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Boom. Authority. And they all sensed it. They all sensed that this lines up with what is true in my heart. This is what God has written in my heart. This has heavy meaning to it. And it's an inner witness. What he's saying is an inner witness to what I believe and know to be true. And these aren't how the scribes teach. They have a dead religion, a dead letter that they teach, but they don't teach the spirit of the law. It's hitting them hard. And so you can see what it means to be a disciple of Jesus, how he just raised the bar in so many areas and destroyed so many misconceptions that they had of what it really meant to know his Father, to know God, and to walk with God, and to be righteous in God's kingdom, and how God was going to accept them in the end. So, okay. I'm done. Any questions? We made it through 7.
No questions. I just think I was just kind of thinking about how, you know, the people that were there, they got to listen to the Sermon on the Mount. You know, how many years they were listening, you know, to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the things that their teachers and the things that they heard. And I was kind of thinking about how, you know, Jesus says, my sheep will know my voice. And then just how astonished, like, I mean, at that very moment when he finished, that feeling of, like, they just knew. It wasn't just like, I don't know, you know, and then they kind of go back to their teachers and then, you know, add it up. They just knew right then and there that this is the truth, and this is, came from heaven, you know. And it was kind of, you know, how amazing would that have been to heard that with your ears?
Yeah, to have been raised under a different understanding of God, and then to have your eyes enlightened that he's still teaching you the scriptures, but he's teaching you what they really meant and what God's original intent was. Mm-hmm. Well, so it's quite eye-opening.
And of course, like you know, growing up Catholic, and then you just knew.
Yeah.
You know, you had your eyes open, and you just kind of knew that, you know, this is the truth.
Yeah.
It's kind of pretty awesome.
It is pretty awesome. There's an awakening process that the Lord does in our hearts. And I think this is what's happening to many people here listening to Jesus. But there's a responsibility of hearing it, because now you got to go and you got to obey it. But it always starts with that inner revelation where God, and I think that's what it means when the Lord draws a man, is he clears out the spiritual fog of their life, you know, whatever sin, whatever demonic oppression they have, he clears all of that out for a moment, for a window in time, and speaks to him and you know it's true, and you know it's him, mm-hmm. and you have an opportunity to respond. And so, you know, that is a window of grace in everybody's life, and then it's what you do with it. And I think that applies to every human being.
Yeah.
I think God tries to do that with every human being. That's just my personal belief, because of what it says in Romans. And there is, I'll show you what why I think that. Romans 1, it's right around here. I'm going to unfreeze it. Okay, so for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, or suppress it. They hold it down. So men are holding down the truth. So they have the truth, but they're suppressing it. So there's truth, there's revelation that God has given them to a certain degree. It's different for every human being. But when they come to the age of accountability, and it can happen at a very young age, but it depends on the light that they have and what they understand to be God's ways, and then violating it, and then they put it down. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. So God himself is showing it unto him. And that which may be known of God is manifest in them. So you can see God's proof that he exists. It's manifest in their own bodies, in the own creation. It says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. So the things that are made understand the invisible things of God from the creation of the world. And so they're understood. All the creatures understand him, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. So God is showing them things. They have an understanding, mm-hmm. but they're holding it down. And it says in John about Jesus that he is the light. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. So all things were made by him. It says the light shines in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Let me see. Yeah, I mean, this life was the light of men. I'm struggling here. Let me pause it. Yeah, it's in verse 9 that was the true light which lights every man that comes into the world. So he is the light. He was not the light. John was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of the light, Jesus. And Jesus was the true light which lights every man that comes into the world. So life comes from, he says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Life comes from Jesus. Every man that comes into the world, they have an understanding of God and the invisible things of God, of how they were created, how creation was made. They know God exists, so that they're without excuse. God has shown them these things, it says. So that's why man is ultimately without excuse. And that revelation comes. And what do you do with the revelation? Are you going to suppress it? Or are you going to finally say, Lord, I'm going to yield to you. I'm going to do what you say because I know it's true. And I'm going to stop wanting my own way and follow after my own sinful heart and desires in this life. And I know you're doing this because you love me. You've created me. And I want to give my life to you. I can't run it well enough anyway. I've screwed it up already anyway, Lord. And you are, you know, he moves on us with love. It says the goodness of God leads us to repentance. So yes, there's a fear of the Lord that takes hold of us too. We see how we've violated God's ways and we've sinned, but there's also his goodness, his drawing to us that leads us to repentance. You know, there's two methods really. And so God ultimately will be our judge, but he desires to be our savior. But that's up to us. And so do we come when we hear and we have revelation, do we respond to it as he wants us to respond? And you know, this is all Jesus is saying. So, you know, you can just picture the responsibilities on us. We have to have ears to hear. It's not enough just to do our Bible reading or go to church and hear a nice sermon. No, we have to really spiritually hear what God is saying for us and then do it. But that he'll make that easy for us as we, you know, just walk wanting to know him. You have a desire like a child. He has a desire as a good father to give you these things. He's not like he's trying to hide these things from you. And then, you know, you keep drawn toward him as you work in that relationship. Is a, you know, it's just like a magnetic pull. That spiritual hunger we talked about. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. They're going to be filled. God's going to bless us. So, yeah, I mean, it was for the Jews, it was they had been taught by the scribes and Pharisees, but they weren't teaching them how God really was. And so Jesus just, I think, blew them away. And they're like, first of all, you're talking to God as if he's your father. Wow, that's an awesome concept. And he wants to, you know, he wants us to do these things that totally make sense. And his character is so opposite that of the world. But yet it's true, it's right, it's good. We know it rings true. It's how we're created. And yeah, it's all about love. You know, it's just, it's exciting. And so yeah, you can see why they were like kind of astonished. Yeah. But it's the ones who did something with it.
Right.
They had to sit down and count the cost now. They heard it. Now what am I going to do with this? Do I really want to do what I believe is true, or am I scared for some other reason? Mm-hmm. So, Sarah, any questions? Mm-hmm.